Good morning. Welcome to Immaculate Heart of Mary Church. Today we are celebrating the 10th Sunday in Ordinary Time. The readings can be found in your red hymnal, number 1137. That is 1137. We are also welcoming today our missionary priest, Father Robert Fath from the Diocese of Fairbanks, Alaska. There will be a second collection today, and any checks should be made out to IHM. Thank you. Our opening hymn is number 538 in the Blue Gather, Come to Us, number 538. Please stand.
Come to me, come to us, you who are burdened. Come to the word and come to the meal. Come without question or pressure or price. Come be embraced by the body of Christ. Come to me, come to us, pilgrim or stranger, looking for change or challenge or light. We are the people whose calling is care, bearers of mercy nourished in prayer. Come to me, come to us, broken or building. Come with your children, your choices, your chains. All are invited to friendship or rest, to share in the struggle, our call and our quest.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Good morning to all of you. My name is Father Robert Fath. I'm a priest of the Missionary Diocese of Fairbanks in Alaska, and it's a pleasure to be able to come down here and to be able to talk to you about the great work that our missionaries are doing throughout the northern half of our state. My brothers and sisters, to prepare ourselves for the celebration of these sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins. Lord Jesus, you came to show us the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you came to bring us the peace of God's kingdom. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you plead for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. To God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy. Take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have
Let us pray. O God, from whom all good things come, grant that we who call on you in our need may at your prompting discern what is right and by your guidance do it. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Genesis. After the man Adam had eaten of the tree, the Lord God called to the man and asked him, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, but I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself." Then he asked, "Who told you that you were naked?" "You have eaten then from the tree of which I had forbidden you to eat," the man replied. "The woman who you put here with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, so I ate it." The Lord God then asked the woman, "Why do you do such a thing?" The woman answered, "The serpent tricked me into it, so I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, you shall be banned from all the animals and from all the wild creatures. On your belly shall you crawl, and dirt shall you eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike at your head, while you strike at his heel." The word of the Lord.
Our psalm is number 113 in your Blue Gather. With the Lord there is mercy, number 113.
With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. From out of the depths I cry unto you, Lord, hear my voice, come hear my prayer. Oh, let your ear be open to my pleading. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. If you, O Lord, should mark our guilt, then who could stand within your sight? But in you is found forgiveness for our failings. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. Just as those who wait for the morning light, even more I long for the Lord my God, whose word to me shall ever be my comfort. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, "I believed, therefore I spoke," we too believe, and therefore we speak, knowing that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and place us with you in his presence. Everything indeed is for you, so that the grace bestowed in abundance on more and more people may cause the thanksgiving to overflow for the glory of God. Therefore, we are not discouraged. Rather, although our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to what is seen, but to what is unseen, for what is seen is transitory, but what is unseen is eternal. For we know that if our earthly dwelling, a tent, should be destroyed, we have a building from God, a dwelling not made with hands, eternal in heaven. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus came home with his disciples. Again, the crowd gathered, making it impossible for them even to eat. When his relatives heard of this, they set out to seize him, for they said he is out of his mind. The scribes who'd come from Jerusalem said, "He is possessed by Beelzebub. And by the prince of demons, he drives out demons." Summoning them, he began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand. That is the end of him. But no one can enter a strong man's house to plunder his property unless he first ties up the strong man. Then he can plunder the house. Amen, I say to you, all sins and all blasphemies that people utter will be forgiven them. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an everlasting sin. For they had said, "He has an unclean spirit." The Gospel of the Lord. Again, good morning to all of you. It's a pleasure to be able to come down from Alaska to be able to talk about the missionary work that we're doing in northern Alaska. Oftentimes when we think about missions and we think about missionary activity, the last place we think about is the United States. When you think of missionaries, you think of places like Africa or the South Seas or Southeast Asia. But very rarely do we recognize that here, even in our own country, there is still mission territory, places where the gospel is still being planted and needs to expand. Well, in the United States, we have two types of missions. The most common mission in the United States is what we call a home mission. Home missions are those places around the country where the faith is established, but maybe it's the minority faith. Maybe they struggle because of resources and access to resources, and they need a little extra help. And so home mission territories would be places like Appalachia or the Deep South or the Northwest of the country. Alaska is also included as a home mission. But the other designation, and the only designation that is given to our diocese, is that of an international mission. And what that means is that the faith is fairly new in comparison to other places in the world, and it requires a lot of extra resources, human resources, to help that faith be planted deeply and to continue to grow. And that's why I come out several times a year to the Lower 48 to visit with all of you, to tell you about the last international mission that we have here in our country. Now, in the state of Alaska, we are blessed to be one of those few states that can make a map with our hand, so it makes it easier for a visual to kind of understand the state of Alaska. The whole state itself is 1/5 the size of what we call the Lower 48, the contiguous United States. And in that area, there are two dioceses. The Archdiocese of Anchorage and Juneau is the Southeast Panhandle, South Central, and the Aleutian Chain. Everything above the Alaska Range, the northern two-thirds of the state, is the Diocese of Fairbanks. The Diocese of Fairbanks is about 410,000 square miles in size. So to put that into comparison, we're a little over twice the size of the state of Texas. Or after looking up the square mileage for Minnesota, we're over 4.5 times the size of your state. And that's just one diocese. We have 46 parishes in northern Alaska. Only 9 of them can be driven to. The rest are out in Alaska Native villages. And so currently we serve 3 general populations of Alaska Natives: the Athabascan Indians of the interior region, the Yupik Eskimo and Chupik Eskimos of the west coast along the Bering Sea, and then the Inupiaq Eskimos of the Seward Peninsula in northern Alaska. And right now, we currently have 22 priests to cover all 46 of those parishes. And of those 22 priests, only 5 of us, myself included, are incarnated priests of the Diocese of Fairbanks. That means we are priests who have been ordained for Fairbanks and will live there for the rest of our lives. The rest of the men who are serving in the missions are either from religious orders, like the Jesuits, the Franciscans, and the Incarnate Word priests, but also international priests. We have men from Zimbabwe, from Nigeria, Poland, and India, and one from Korea. And these men have dedicated their lives to going out to some of the most remote places in the world, in our own country, to bring the gospel of Christ to others. And we have this missionary designation, one, because we're so far north, but also because of how difficult it is for us to get around within our own diocese. Most of the parishes, as I said, are out in villages, which means they're only accessible by small plane. And once our missionaries get out to the villages, they travel this time of year by boat along the river system to the various parishes. And in the winter, they travel by snow machine, or I guess what you call snowmobiles down here. And many of the men who are assigned to the village parishes will travel between 3, 4, or 5 of those villages, which means that the faithful are only receiving the sacraments about every 4 to 6 weeks. That reception of the sacraments and that bringing of the faith is complicated by the weather and by changes in the weather. I didn't mention this last night, but one of our villages, the village of Newtok, which I was out in 20 years ago, is having to be relocated to a new village site called Murtarvik. When I was out in that village 20 years ago, the river was over a football field's length from the airstrip. Now the airstrip is closed because it has been eaten away by the river, and they figure within the next 5 or 6 years, the village itself will no longer exist. And so the people are having to move their entire lives, their families, to this new village site, which also means that at some point, the church will need to build a new church at the new village site. And that's one of the reasons that we come out. We are also complicated because of transportation and getting food and fuel out to the villages. As you can imagine, living in Alaska itself means that the cost of living is generally higher than it is here in the Lower 48, but it gets even higher when you go out to the villages. Last night, someone said you're paying about $5 or so for milk in your stores. We're paying anywhere between $15 to $20 a gallon in the villages. Frozen pizzas that you get for about 10 bucks are going for about $25. And the price of unleaded fuel, at least this year, is around $18 a gallon. And those prices fluctuate depending on when the fuel is delivered and what the national average is. So you can imagine the economic strain that's put on the people, but also on our priests as well. And because of that, many of our priests live as the people do in the villages. They live a subsistence or a semi-subsistence lifestyle. And what that means is that when the people of the village go out hunting, the priest goes with them. When they're out fishing, they're fishing with them. When they're out berry picking, they're out berry picking with them. And so it's a unique way to live, where most of us are used to, you know, going to the corner store and grabbing our food. Our priests and our villagers will typically go out and find that moose, and they will feed their family for an entire year off of one animal. And so it's hard work, but it's good work. And it's work that not only our priests enjoy being part of, but the people themselves as well. One of the things that I've noticed in my travels out to the villages is the joyfulness that the people have and the desire to receive the sacraments. I've had the opportunity to travel to a number of our villages, but one in particular really sticks with me, and that's the village of Immaculate, which is a Yupik Eskimo village about 8 miles from the mouth of the Yukon River near the Bering Sea. And the first time I went out to the village, I flew out on a small plane, and when I landed on the airstrip, I had someone meet me there with a four-wheeler, thank God. Because it's a 2-mile walk into the village if you don't have transportation. And I was brought into the village, and the first thing that I did after getting established in the rectory was to get onto the VHF. Every home in the villages more or less has a VHF radio, and that's their normal way of communicating. And I just got on the radio and said, the priest is here, mass is at this time, confessions will be at this time, hope to see you. And so as I was settling in the rectory, there was a knock at the door. And when I opened the door, there was a woman just a little older than me with this big grin on her face. And she said, Father, you're here. I'm praying for bad weather. And I went, excuse me? And she goes, well, if the weather is bad, the planes can't fly. And if the planes can't fly, you can't leave. And so this became sort of a running joke between us as I would go out to Immaculate several times a year. And it finally got to the point when she would come and say, Father, I'm praying for bad weather. I would tell her, well, I've placed the Blessed Mother in the window for good weather, so hopefully she'll help me. But that just shows the level of desire that they have for us to be there. And another way they show that desire as well is just in their conversation with you. Now, if I came into your parish and you said to me, when are you leaving? I would be insulted, because in, at least in our Western Anglo understanding, it kind of has a negative connotation. But for our natives, saying when are you leaving really denotes this desire for relationship. How long are you staying? We want to get to know you. We want to tell our stories. We want you to know who we are, who our families are, who our children are, and to be part of our life. And so instead of wanting to get rid of the priest, what they're really saying is, stay with us. Be part of our community. Be part of our family. And so these are the people that we go out and serve and bring the gospel of Christ to. And this is one of the reasons that I come out and do mission appeals on a regular basis for the Diocese of Fairbanks. Unlike your archdiocese, Fairbanks is unique in that we have an inverse funding model in the diocese. So here in Minneapolis, St. Paul, your parish helps to support the work that the chancery does, the archdiocesan programs that you have. In Fairbanks, 89% of our operating income comes from outside of Alaska. It comes from donors like you. And where your chancery is supported by you, our chancery supports 37 of our 46 parishes. A majority of our parishes and the villages are fully subsidized by the diocese. And that's just for the basics, keeping the lights on, making sure there's fuel in the tank, getting our priests and religious around to the different villages. And it's very expensive to do that. It was actually cheaper for me to fly here to Minneapolis to be with all of you this weekend than it is for me to go out to visit the people in my own parishes and the villages. On average, when we send a priest out to those remote parishes, it will cost us anywhere between $1,000 to $1,200 round trip just for the flight. That doesn't count all of the other expenses that are involved. And then, of course, there's the expenses of catechetical materials and all those other things that are needed in order to help promote the faith. And that's why I come to see you, because people in Alaska are hungering for the sacraments, and they need your help in order to receive them. And there are so many benefits that flow from them. I see how our parishes grow, how they carry on because of the support that you give. One individual who was very striking to me as a young priest was a man named Benedict Tucker, Ben Tucker. He lived in the village of Immaculate, and when I met him, he had told me he was in his late 90s. His family told me he was probably over 100. He had no birth certificate, and he was born in a village called Akulurak that no longer exists. Ben described himself as the last real Eskimo in the village. He remembered the first time that the Jesuit missionaries came to his home village of Akulurak. He was a toddler, and he was baptized by them at about the age of two or three, we're not really sure. And he remembers seeing those priests, especially in the wintertime, coming into his village by dog sled. And when they were there, they would gather the children together, they would do catechesis, they would celebrate Mass, hear confessions. And this struck Ben as a young man. And as he grew older and he became an adult, he became one of our first lay catechists in Alaska. And Ben traveled from Akulurak and later from Immaculate to the surrounding villages, not only to help train other catechists, but to train the children and the faithful in the sacraments and in the scriptures. Well, about 8 years ago or so, Ben died. When he passed away, the little church in Immaculate was filled to overflowing. Now keep in mind, their church is probably only as big as this section of pews in your own church. But people from all over the region who knew Ben, who had been taught by Ben, came to pray with him and his family after his death. He couldn't have been catechized, and he couldn't have been prepared for his missionary work without your help. Another couple that really inspires me is a husband and wife who were in my first youth group when I was ordained 17 years ago, Harley and Alex. They're now married, and they have 5 children of their own, and they're teachers in the village of Point Hope. Point Hope, Alaska is in the extreme northwest corner of the state of Alaska. It sits on a gravel bar 3 miles out into the ocean, and it divides the Bering and Chukchi Seas. And what's unique about the village of Point Hope is it's not a Catholic village, yet this is a Catholic family. Every Sunday, Harley and Alex take their children to the local Protestant church to pray with the other villagers and to pray in community with them. But then afterwards, they take their children home and they instruct them in the Catholic faith. I was able to go out there and visit them this past year after there was a tragedy in the village, and I was impressed with how well their children are catechized. 2 of their 5 have already received First Confession and First Communion, and quite frankly, they're better catechized than most of our children in urban areas. They know the faith better than kids that have the benefit of Sunday school and Catholic schools. And it's because their parents are so in love with the faith that they want to pass it on. And we help them to do that by providing them with the materials they need in the absence of a priest, in the absence of a Catholic church, to be able to raise their children in the faith. But that's only possible because of you. Our diocese was founded in the late 1950s, early 1960s by Pope Pius. And in the foundational documents and his reflection on Alaska, there were 2 statements that he made that stick with all of us who are missionaries in northern Alaska. The first is he called Fairbanks a most difficult mission. And even today, 50, 60 years after our foundation, it still is a most difficult mission, trying to get around to all of those parishes, given the different challenges that we face. But the other thing he did was he reminded all of us that missionary activity is not limited just to those of us who are in the missions. He wrote that some serve the missions by going, some go to the missions by giving. And that's what I'm asking you to do today, is to go to the missions by giving. Help us to continue to do the good work of the church in northern Alaska. After communion today, we'll have a second collection for the Diocese of Fairbanks. And I ask you to reflect on your own experience of the faith, your own experience of your parish here. You are so, so blessed that you have this parish that has two priests, including a newly minted baby priest right here, to serve you. You have the opportunity on Sunday to go to Mass multiple times. You can go to daily Mass. You can call the parish office or the rectory and go to confession or receive the anointing of the sick anytime you want. Our people in Northern Alaska don't have that benefit. I'm the only homegrown priest for the Diocese of Fairbanks, and my prayer and my hope is that one day we will have a priest for every parish, because I want my people, my parishioners, to experience what you have here. And with your help and your blessing, that will happen. And so as we take the second collection up, I ask you to be as generous as you can. Help to spread the gospel and to help keep the sacraments alive in Northern Alaska. And even if you're not able to financially give, we ask you to please pray. Pray that the gospel will continue to grow in the hearts and minds of the people of Northern Alaska as our missionaries go out into this most difficult mission to bring them the love and the mercy of Jesus Christ. So on behalf of the people of the Diocese of Fairbanks, I say to all of you, Koyana, Koyana Chuknuk. Thank you. Thank you very much for your prayer and for your support of our missionary activities in Northern Alaska. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Knowing that we have a Father in heaven who hears the voice of his children, we confidently bring before him our prayers and our petitions.
For the Church, that with the help of the Holy Spirit, we may better discern God's will, so that we may follow it wholeheartedly and sincerely, making the kingdom increasingly present here on earth, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may work tirelessly to drive out evil in the world, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have no home or whose home is unsafe, unhealthy, or unstable, that they may experience God's mercy, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For students at every level who have graduated or are graduating, that they may take pride in their accomplishments and never lose the joy of learning, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the mission of Father Robert Fath and the people of the Diocese of Fairbanks, that they may be abundantly blessed by God and would know and experience our support, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the special intentions in our parish, for those who are sick or homebound especially Mary Grace Whalen, Joan Carlson, and Nancy Jones, for those who have died, and for the Bruner family for whom this Holy Mass is being offered, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we bring before you all these petitions, those that we have spoken out loud and those that we hold in the silence of our hearts, and we ask you to answer them through Christ our Lord.
Our preparation hymn is number 425 in your blue gather, All That We Have, number 425.
All that we have and all that we offer comes from our heart, both frightened and free. Take what we bring now and give what we need. All done in His name. Some would rely on their power. Others put trust in their gold. Some have only their Savior, whose faithfulness never grows old. All that we have and all that we offer comes from our heart, both frightened and free. Take what we bring now and give what we need. All done in His name. Sometimes the road may be lonesome. Often we may lose our way. Take courage and always remember, love isn't just for a day. All that we have and all that we offer comes from our heart, both frightened and free. Take what we bring now and give what we need. All done in His name.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look kindly upon our service, O Lord, we pray, that what we offer may be an acceptable oblation to you, and lead us to grow in charity, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being, and while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so, with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as you look forward to a second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Bernard, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you, and your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, 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 amen.
the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with
your spirit. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us your peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Our communion hymn is number 485 in your blue gather, City of God, number 485. 5.
Turn.
God in the barren spaces, God in the deep, God in the silences that call us to seek, God in the desert, God in the waste, God who is everywhere, be in this place. Son who is one like us, in all things but sin, Son who calls beauty from the darkness within, Son of obedience, Son of the
Let us pray. May your healing work, O Lord, free us, we pray, from doing evil and lead us to what is right, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
We just have a couple announcements this week. The block party is next Saturday. Just a note for those planning to attend, we will be accepting cash or check only for bingo and beer. The food trucks will accept credit cards. The schedule for the day's event can be found in the bulletin. Plan to stay for the day, and you won't want to miss beer choir from 6 to 8 p.m. you can sign up on our website. All 55 and better friends are invited for a pontoon ride on Wednesday, June 19th at 10 a.m. on Lake Riley. Deadline to sign up is June 14th. Call the parish office if you'd like to go. IHM is hosting a blood drive on Wednesday, July 3rd. Please see the bulletin for more information. Next weekend for the block party masses, there will be a half hour of Marian music in church before the start of each mass on Sunday and 45 minutes before mass on Saturday.
Again, Koyana, for your hospitality. Thank you for having me here this weekend. It's always a pleasure to be able to come out of Alaska and talk about the great work that our missionaries are doing in Northern Alaska. As you leave this morning, there's a card table in the back, and there are some bookmarks sitting out that have a little bit of information on the back of them. And there is a QR code. If you scan that code, it'll take you to the diocesan website where you can look up the history of our diocese, our parishes, and see all of the different works that our men and women religious are involved in throughout Northern Alaska. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace, glorifying God by your lives.
Our closing hymn is number 400 in your Blue Gather, Lead Me, Guide Me, number 400.
Lead me, guide me along the way. For if you lead me, I cannot stray. Lord, let me walk each day with thee. Lead me, O Lord, lead me. I'm weak and I need thy strength and power to help me over my weakest hour. Help me through
that's a priest.